Welcome to Adventures North. I'm your host, Steve MacInnis. Our adventure begins in Arctic Quebec's Nunavik region and the village of Kangiqsualujjuaq. Located just inland from the southeastern corner of Ungava Bay, this friendly Inuit settlement of 750 residents is situated in a remote mountainous region at the mouth of the mighty George River and the nearby Koroc River. In part one of this two-part special, a group of local Inuit guides and Nunavik Parks personnel take us with them to explore and document an adventure in one of Nunavik's newest parks, the Kuururjuaq Park and the Koroc River and Valley. This exceptionally pristine area is steeped in legend about spirits and bountiful fish and game that have sustained Inuit here for generations. Next, Park Warden Peter Ananak describes this new and unique cultural learning experience and winter camping adventure.
The trip that you're going to do, the first day will be 40 kilometers to be from the community Kangiqsualujjuaq. You're going to go through the tundra, and when you reach the first lake, there's going to be trees, and from there there's going to be more trees, so less wind for you. Since it's a valley, for sure it's going to be a lot warmer. So the destination you're going to reach for the first day will be Hamunil fishing. And at the same time, my partner, for sure, he's going to go on the ptarmigan hunt. Local elder, Sarah, she's going to do her demonstration. Her daily activities, such as fishing, cooking bannock. And for the second day, weather permitting, from Hamunialuk to the waterfall called Hokluduk. That's going to be another 40 kilometer. All the way, you're going to use the river as a trail all the way through the trees and through the mountains. Going to the waterfalls, it's higher altitude, so it might be a little bit colder. For the third day, from Hokluduk waterfalls to Kangiqsualujjuaq community, you're going to do the return trip, 80 kilometers all in one. So the last day you're going to have is just travel. Just in case, we're going to bring a hamotik. We're going to have extra warm clothes in case one of our clients get too cold or hypothermic. Plus, we're going to have emergency case and communication equipment.
On communication, we have spot, satellite phone, GPS, yeah, a gun,
How does that work with the guns? You each bring a rifle?
All the guys, they're going to bring their own gun. If we're lucky enough to see a polar bear, if there's tracks or trails of polar bear or wolves, for sure they're going to be worried that if there's a animal nearby, for sure they're going to be alert at all times. We have lots of snow, so some areas going to be a little bit slushy, but since we have enough snow, you can go right on top of it. You're going to go through the trails easily. Some area, for sure, it's going to be powder, deep snow, up to 1 meter, so you're going to need some snowshoe.
The next morning, the group of us left the village headed for the Kuururjuaq Park and the Koroc River. It had been snowing all week, so we had an untouched layer of fresh snow for the first leg of our journey across the wide open tundra. The landscape blanketed in white is beautiful. I remember thinking how rare it is to travel such distances, and the only break in the snow cover is where patches of bare rock or tracks left by animals or snowmobiles are visible. The views were extraordinary, and mile after mile, this vast virgin wilderness just kept surprising and pleasing the eye. The first big lake we encountered marked the spot where stands of trees started appearing along the lower elevations of the hilly shorelines. It took about 10 minutes to cross the main lake and get to the point on shore where the trails through the forest begin. This was one of the most beautiful and exciting parts of the ride. When we emerged from the trail, we stopped at the crest of a hill to take in the spectacular views all around us. From here, we had an elevated view of the frozen Koroc River, our highway for the rest of the way to camp, and what will be our playground for the next few days. This is the halfway point of today's trip, where we actually enter the park. From the edge of the valley, we have a short run down the hill, through the shoreline trees, and out onto the ice below. As our caravan pushes further upstream, the scenery gets more and more interesting, with taller, steeper mountains and more shoreline trees all compressed into narrowing stretches of the river. When we arrive at the camp, the whole team springs into action, getting the camp ready for a two-night stay. It's an unspoken teamwork, and everything comes together quickly. Within a half hour or so, the wood has been gathered, the tents are comfortably warm, and there's food cooking and hot tea boiling on the stoves. Along the trail at the edge of camp, Yako has discovered a beautiful marten caught in one of his traps. And Annie is busy plucking a freshly harvested ptarmigan that will be added to tonight's menu. Rumor has it that our camp is located right beside one of the best fishing pools on the entire river. Disguised by the ice and snow cover, the blue-green, crystal-clear waters of the Koroc River are truly pristine and home to a prolific Arctic char fishery. The first thing that you notice about ice fishing Inuit style is how practical everything is. To start with, the traditional method to make a hole in the ice is with an ice chisel, or chipper. They're really effective, and so there's no need to carry a gas auger or fuel for it. Then there's the tackle and equipment. A willow twig with 12 feet of line and a small silver lure tied to it. That's it. The fishing was amazing, and one angler in particular seemed to catch fish wherever she dropped her line. Sarah Ananak is a local fishing legend, and living up to her reputation, she put on quite a show for us. This classic Inuit pose shows Sarah shielding the hole with her shadow and blowing the ice chips to the side of the hole so she can see down into the water to watch the fish swim around and approach the lure. She talks to the fish and uses finesse jigging skills like short pauses, subtle twitches of the lure, and fast hook sets. It's like she coaxes each one onto the line personally. The Inuit are expert anglers. It's part of their culture. They've been fishing through the ice for hundreds of years, using tools, techniques, and locations passed down through the generations. In the South, we've become so advanced in our fishing ways that we sometimes forget that the basics still work pretty well. Ice fishing Inuit style reminds us that you don't need a lot of specialized equipment or power tools to go ice fishing, and that fish can be fooled with the simplest of things. In the end, Sarah caught 27 Arctic char, including a couple of 10-pounders, more than enough for us to eat a few, plus a bunch to take back and share in the village. For the Southerners in the group, the cultural aspect of our experience was truly fascinating. We learned many interesting things, and we enjoyed excellent meals and snacks made with indigenous country foods like caribou, ptarmigan, and Arctic char. Sarah kept busy making an endless supply of freshly made bannock that was a big hit with everyone as well. Sarah showed her eager students how she goes about her regular activities while winter camping, and it proves to be really enlightening. Caribou are an important part of the Inuit culture as a traditional source of food and material for clothing, tools, and shelter. Caribou meat is eaten raw as well as cooked. It's very lean and tasty, one of my all-time favorite meats. The hides are used for making traditional tents, mats for sleeping, or for sitting on while ice fishing or riding in a hammock. For use as clothing, the hide is scraped to remove remnants of hair and to soften the hide before sewing.
I think we will do a trail around 3 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, so we will bring some food with us and some communication. We have a good equipment for you, a good snowshoes, a good pole. We have a good weather. We are 3 people exciting to go up in the mountain. It's beautiful, very nice view. It's majestic, beautiful. Sometimes it's really shallow, and sometimes it goes up to here. So yeah, it can be really deep at times. Yeah, and there are little rivers and stuff, so you have to be careful. Had to step in. Tomasi almost broke through the ice. So it's not easy at all times, and it's yeah. There are some steep parts, so you have to be careful.
We have a good hill with an inclination 35. So that's a good challenge. The trekking and snowshoeing. That's a good part. Yeah, I like that.
From camp, it's an 80-kilometer round-trip tour to the waterfall area, which is upriver and inland through more spectacular winter landscapes of the Koroc River Valley. One of the highlights of this excursion was stopping at points of interest along the way, and learning the stories behind the strange Inuit place names given to some of the physical landmarks.
There was 2 caribous, ran to the top without stopping, without looking back. The man was surprised, and he called that mountain Kuururjuaq since then, because they ran without stopping from bottom to the top.
Everything worked out fine. And I got her, she was tapping me on the back.
That's an extreme trail.
Just spent 3 days on the land, a winter adventure. We went into the park with a group of people, and I'm curious to hear your thoughts now that we're back in the village, how things went on the trip.
The thing that that first comes to my mind is how privileged I feel to have been part of this trip, that the Inuit people welcome me on their territory, and being on the polar bear's territory too. That was really special, and it had a strong effect on me.
Let's talk about the group that was looking after us. We had a group of six local Inuit people here. Yeah. Talk about the interaction and the feelings we had as a group.
Oh wow, they were so great. I felt really well taken care of. They're really welcoming, and I feel that I lived a little bit of their life with them on that trip, and I felt safe, in good hands. I felt like anything could have happened and I would have been okay with them. You don't have to be an extreme adventurer to go there with that team. It's a way to go in the wild, but safely, because of the wardens and the Inuit people that came with us. I mean, that's the best way to see this land and feeling secure about it, and going as far as we did.
You had the opportunity to do a little snowshoeing.
Oh, that was so beautiful. We had a great overview on the Koroc River, and you could hear the silence from the mountain, and all this mystical feeling about being in those big mountains. You feel so small in that immensity. It was a splendid experience, and being with an Inuit guide also, he could talk about his experience, his past experience on the land, and there was a lot of fresh snow. It was so beautiful, and there's no tracks, so you're by yourself in the wild. It was really, really beautiful. It's accessible, and you're gonna be a part of something that you'll never forget. It's one of the best adventures you can have. The Inuit culture, that's something really special that you have to live once in your life.
Sum it up in one word.
Oh, majestic, authentic.
That's two.
Two.
And I'll add one more word, extraordinary. When the adventure continues in part two, we tour more of Kuururjuaq Park. We start with a visit to the traditional hunting, fishing, and trapping area used by local Inuit for generations. Then, from our base camp on the Ongava coast, we'll head out onto the sea ice to discover the area's scenery and hopefully encounter some wildlife along the way. Thanks for watching. Until next time, our adventure never ends.
Adventures North has been brought to you by Lund Boats, Mercury Outboards, and Tourism Quebec.
You know what? I gotta tell you, the women on this trip, they did all the cooking, they did all the cleaning, they out snowshoed the Inuit guides climbing the mountain, leaving them in the tracks. And then we go ice fishing, and Sarah, I think she caught 27 char, twice as many as all the men put together. So, you know, it's a good place for couples to come.
Mm-hmm.
Men, women, it doesn't matter. It's not like in the old days where it was just for the boys.
Yeah, exactly. I agree.